ప్రపన్న పారిజాతాయ తోత్ర వేత్రైకపాణయే జ్ఞానముద్రాయ కృష్ణాయ గీతామృతదుహే నమః. ఓం. డియర్ ఫ్రెండ్స్, వెల్కమ్ టు ది స్టడీ ఆఫ్ గీత. వీఆర్ రీడింగ్ ది 13th చాప్టర్ ఆఫ్ గీత, దట్ ఈస్ ద క్షేత్ర క్షేత్రజ్ఞ విభాగ యోగ. సో వీ హ్యావ్ బీన్ సీయింగ్ దట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎ వెరీ very subtle subject, very intricate things are being, very subtle things are being told, and unless we pay some attention, we will not be able to grasp the overall meaning. So Krishna has been saying that the entire universe is divided into two categories, can be seen in two ways, that is two categories, that is, one is the knower and the other is known. One is that drushya, the seer, the person who notices it, who cognizes it, and the other thing is the insentient, which is seen. And all this kshetram, kshetram is the entire external universe, and also the body-mind complex is called the kshetram, because the entire body-mind complex also can be objectified, it can be seen as an object. And the mind, the knower or the intelligence is something which is not part of the body-mind complex. It is something which is reflected in this intellect, reflected in the what is called buddhi, whatever is called that buddhi of a human being or of an animal, that supreme consciousness which reflects in all these things, that is the knower. And that consciousness reflecting in the antahkarana is also called kshetrajna, it is also called jiva. So these are the words which we have seen so far. So in the 18th shloka we said, Krishna said, so far I have explained what is kshetram, what is jnanam, what is jnayam, etc. And a person who knows this, he becomes me. That is a Brahmavit, Brahmaiva Bhavati. That is a grand statement which he made. Then the next shloka, that is 19th shloka, is coming to another interesting question, which we usually have. When was the universe created? So if you go to some religion, of course some Western religions, they say, okay, God created the universe, say about a few thousand years ago. And even now, many people, even in the so-called advanced countries, the so-called advanced countries, many people even today believe that the universe was created by God in maybe about 6,000 years ago from now. So then what do our people say? Our people, they say, they go to a panchanga, what we call almanac. If you take any Indian panchanga, that panchanga says srushtyabdaha. There is a statement called srushtyabdaha. That is right from the beginning of creation, how many years have passed by. And it tells so many billion years. You see the contrast. Here it says so many billion years. And this number, how they have arrived at? Of course, people who know this Vedic astronomy, etc., they will be able to say Vedic mathematics and astronomy, they will be able to explain. I am not able to explain. Whereas the fact is, the Vedas, or the not Upanishads, the Vedas tell about that particular Vedic Ganita. Veda Ganitam tells about that particular age. And in fact, this is some one thing which has astonished the Westerners, because the Western people, when they came to India, so they wanted to fit everything into their framework, because they, according to them, God created only a few thousand years ago. And if we say that Vedas, they are 10,000 years old, or Mahabharata is some 5,000 years old, they are just unable to accept it, because what all is there in the entire world, it has to fit into their framework, knowledge framework. So that was their problem. So then they said, no, it can't be that old, etc., etc. But then, now science is saying, not about Vedas, not about the antiquity of the Vedas or Bharatam, etc. It is telling about the Srushti. It is telling that this present universe, whatever in this present universe is there, the age of the earth, say about 8.4, I'm not very sure, so many billion years. And what our panchangas say is almost approximate to that. And that is the reason why the astronomers, they are surprised. And one astronomer very honestly has admitted, one astronomer, very famous astronomer, who started that series called Cosmos on the American TV. There is a series called Cosmos, run by some other gentleman after Carl Sagan. Carl Sagan wrote a series of books called Cosmos. So in that, he says, the understanding about time by the Indians is something which is astonishing. And the figures which they give are almost approximate, they are almost tallying with what modern science says. So that is what he says. That is a very candid, or rather frank admission about our understanding of the creation. So now, what do we say? Let us see. What does Krishna say? 19th shloka. Prakrutim purusham shaiva vidhyana divubhavapi vikaranscha gunanscha vidhi prakruti sambhavan. This shloka is a very tough shloka also. It's a very tough shloka. Unless we listen to, I will repeat also, because my job is to explain in as simple terms as possible. If I skip it and tell some story, I am not doing justice to Lord Krishna. I will not be doing justice to Gita. So, whatever you may think, I will have to explain. So, prakrutim purusham chaiva vidhi anadi ubhav api. You see the splitting of words. Prakruti on one hand, purusha on one hand. Purusham cha eva vidhi. Vidhi means you please know, you understand. Anadi ubhav api. Ubhav api means both of them. Both Prakruti and also Purusha, they are all anadi. They are not all, they are both anadi. So what is this Prakruti? Prakruti means the Kshetram, what is called the body or the universe. You can refer, take anything. What all we see as universe and what all we see as the body-mind complex, that is what is called Prakruti. Prakarshena karoti iti Prakruti. That which is, from that Prakruti only, so many trees are born, so many animals are born. So because so many, it is the source for all these things, that is called Prakruti. So Prakruti is, in other words, it is called Kshetra. And Purusha, what is this Purusha? Purusha is not a new word. Purusha is the same as Kshetrajna. We should not be confused by words. So Purusha is Kshetrajna. He is also called Jiva. And if we go back to the 7th chapter, in the very beginning of 7th chapter, Krishna said, I have got two Prakrutis. I have got two Prakrutis. What are they? One is called lower Prakruti and one is higher Prakruti. That is, from that supreme reality, there are two strands which appear. That is, one is called lower Prakruti and other is a higher Prakruti. What is this lower Prakruti? Lower Prakruti is Mahabhutani, Ahankara, Buddhi, Avyakta, all these things which can be seen, which can be objectified. That is Kshetram. Kshetram is the lower Prakruti. And Jiva. Jiva is apareyamitasvanyam jivabhutam. Jivabhutam. Jivabhutam, that is what 7th chapter said. That is the higher Prakruti is the Jiva, the knower. One is the known, the other is the knower. So whatever is Kshetram is lower. Whatever is knower, that is the intelligence aspect of it, that is higher. So here he says, Krishna is saying that Kshetram and also this Kshetrajna, Purusha. Purusha is Jiva. Jiva has also got a tentative appearance only, tentative reality only. That Jiva, of course, when I say tentative reality, the body-mind complex. So Jiva, so long as he identifies himself with the body-mind complex, he has a tentative reality. Once he realizes that he is the same, his nature is the same as supreme reality, then he becomes that supreme reality. It is something, he becomes Ananta, eternal. Nitya. So anyway, here what is he saying? Prakrutim purusham chaiva vidhi anadi ubhavapi. Both the things you please know as anadi. Kshetrajna is anadi, that is jiva, and also prakruti also is anadi. What is the meaning of anadi? On this word anadi, there is a big discussion. Because in Gita, in Vedanta, in Gita, as I was telling you yesterday, Gita is like a tiger in cow's skin. It does not mean that something which is cheating you, which is deadly and all that, not like that. Superficially, it looks very smooth. But if you want to explain, if you want to understand it, you have to see so many, you have to explain so many paradoxical words, paradoxical statements. So here, what is this anadi? Anadi can be interpreted in two ways in Sanskrit, because Sanskrit again is such a language where for a word, you can derive the meaning in 2-3 different ways. So for this word anadi, na plus adi, anadi, that is the clear normal word, na plus adi. Adi means something which is beginning, na adi, that is beginningless, that is na vidyate adihi, ayoho, na vidyate. For them there is no adi, there is no beginning, both are You cannot say when Brahman has come into existence, Prakriti has come into existence. You cannot say when Jiva has come into existence, because these two things are there along with that supreme reality only. When we say that supreme reality is there, that's pure consciousness, and that pure consciousness has the manifesting power, and when has it manifested? It has always been there, because a man and his energy or ability to manifest, it cannot be hidden. So when consciousness is there, its manifesting power also is there. Shiva Shaktya Yukto Yadi, what we see in that Saundarya Lahari, both are existing right from the beginning. So there is no question of when. You go back to billions and billions and billions of years, it is still there at that time, because it is anadi. And anantam also, after billions and billions and billions of years also, this consciousness or intelligence is very much, it will always be there. So that is the point. So of course, here of course we may raise a question, how do we say that the age of the earth is 80 years, 8 billion years, etc., etc. There, we have to realize that our idea of time is not a linear concept of time. Our idea is cyclical concept of time, because we have got what is called Srushti Sthiti Laya, Srushti Sthiti Laya. So in that cyclical concept of time, one Srushti comes and goes back, and again another Srushti comes. So it is like that. So that is how we have to explain this 8 billion years or 10 billion years, otherwise we can't explain. So we leave that question now. Let us see what is meant by this Anadi. Anadi, one meaning is Navidyate Adihi Yayoho. That is what is called one particular samasa called Bahurihi samasa. Bahurihi, I will not go into that. Then another meaning is Na Adi. They are not old at all. Na Adi. That is, they are not old at all. They have been created sometime in the middle. At some point of time, God has created it. So what is the problem in these two? What is the contradiction? We'll just see. We'll just take a break and come back. Let us come back. We are seeing the meaning of this word called Anadi. Anadi, the two, one way is to say Navidyate Adihi Ayoho Iti Anadi. That is, these two things for which there is no Adi, that is, there is no beginning, they are totally beginningless. You just cannot, you go back and back and back and back in time, billions and billions and billions of years, they are always there. Navidyate Adihi. And another meaning is Na Adi. That means they are not old. Adi means old, isn't it? Na Adi, they are not so old. They were created sometime by the God. God suddenly appeared, and then God said, yes, I am going to create it, and then he created it. So then what will you accept? So Vedanta has accepted the first explanation, that is Navidyate Adihi, that is, there is no origin for this. They are both originless. That is, right from the time of you can't use the word time also, because Brahman is again timeless, Akal, Sat Shri Akal. So because Brahman is timeless, there is no question of beginning for that. Similarly, because Brahman is timeless, the manifesting power also is timeless. The manifesting power, which is called Prakriti or Maya, that is also timeless. So that is why they say Maya also is Anadi. Then earlier also we saw that Anadi. Then Anadimat Param Brahma Visa Nasattan Asaduchyate in the same chapter. So then the second meaning, that is Anadi, that is, they are not old, they are created at some point of time. Then what is the problem in accepting it? Suppose you say that, yes, God created universe some 5000 years ago or 6000 years ago. Suppose you say that. What is the problem? Then you know that God is there, he has always been there for billions and billions and billions of years. You can't say that God also appeared at some point of time. All religions, they do accept that God is there eternally. So if God has been there eternally, what was he doing till about 6000 years ago? So that is the question. In fact, without knowing all the what the other Western religions are saying, Shankaracharya has given a long discussion. In fact, I request you to listen, to see the, if you know Sanskrit or if you are interested, you see the commentary under this particular shloka, 13th chapter, 19th shloka. You please see the commentary. There is a very interesting discussion. Shankaracharya did not know all this Western theology and whatnot. But there is a discussion, and Krishna, of course, Shankaracharya, okay, you can even say Shankaracharya is from 8th century, he knew Western theology. But Lord Krishna did not know. Lord Krishna did not know Western theology. So, but he is saying it with Dhyanadi. So, what is the difficulty to say that God has created them somewhere in the middle? So, if you say that, then you have to say that God, though he has been existing for the billions and billions and billions of years, he was idle, he was sitting idle for a long, 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 long time. And only about 6,000 years ago, he suddenly thought, okay, let me create this universe. Why that? Then that will be a problem. And Shankaracharya uses an expression, Ishitavya Abhavat Ishwarasya Anishwaratva Prasangaha. Then before the creation of the whole universe, there is nothing for the God to overlord, to supervise. So we call the God omniscient, omnipotent, etc., etc. Then prior to 6000 BC, God was not omniscient, omnipotent, etc. Because there was nothing to rule over. You can't call him the ruler, omnipotent, etc. Because there was nothing to rule over. So that is the problem. So you have to accept that there is something called, you can't say that God created the universe at a particular point of time. It has always been there. Then another problem also will come. Another problem is related to what is called transmigration. You see, we know that when the Srushti takes place, all the beings are created according to their karma, whatever is the past karma. Otherwise, you can't explain the diversity in creation, because the diversity in creation is explained by the theory of karma only, by the postulation, or at least not theory, hypothesis, let us say. The hypothesis of karma is explaining the diversity in the universe. Because somebody is rich, somebody is born poor, somebody is lame, somebody is blind, somebody is so physically fit. All these things are there. And how can you attribute it to all this inequality to God? You can't say God is just whimsical. God is all powerful, he can do what all he wants. So you can't say that. Then if that is so, then God is either whimsical or he is a partisan. He is favoring some people, he is not favoring some people, which again is, you know, it should not be the equality of God. God is equal to all. So then, what will happen to this transmigration? Suppose transmigration is there, and this samsara is due to, samsara means samsaranam, that is transmigration. Transmigration is due to whatever karma is there. And once that is so, you know how to get rid of it. So the karma is the cause for this transmigration. And if that is so, you do some nishkama karma. You also realize, you also know, try to know the truth, you also purify yourself, and then you, by Atma Sayama, by Yoga and all these things, you purify the mind and also do the Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. And again, like Krishna said in the last shloka, Madbhavaya Upavadyate, you become that Brahman. So you are getting rid of all these things and you are realizing moksha. You are what is called moksha, that liberation you are attaining. If we say that, both are anadi. Suppose you say that there is no, God has just created it for no reason. God has created it without any cause. If that is so, then there will be no moksha also. So the cause for creation is karma. And you have got a strategy to get rid of karma. And all the Vedanta Shastra, all Shastras, they talk about moksha and whatnot. So if without any cause, suppose the God has created. Nirnimittatve. Nirnimittam means if suppose there is no cause for creation at all. If there is no cause for creation, then what will happen? There is no question of moksha also. If there is a cause, you have got strategy to get rid of it. If there is no cause at all and he has created, there is no question of moksha also. That has to go on and on. The samsaranam has to go on and on and on. So that again is not acceptable. All the moksha shastra, the Vedanta shastra, it will become redundant, ridiculous. So that is what these two arguments, commentators, they say. So even if we do not believe in what is called rebirth, suppose there are people who believe in rebirth, there are many people who do not believe in rebirth. So even in the Western countries now, there is a lot of research which is going on about the rebirth. There is what a psychologist, many psychologists and such people, they are doing what is called past life regression. Past life regression, that hypnosis and by various means, they are trying to take a patient to the past life. And in many cases, in some cases, they have also established, yes, so-and-so person is talking about something somewhere which he has not even seen in the entire lifetime. So some boy or girl, some 8-year-old, 9-year-old, talks about something, some strange country which he has not even seen. So these are the things, this past life regression. Many people are now coming to believe that there is what is called past life. When you say that there is past life, there is also a future life. So that is something which is automatic. So this then what is the cause for this punarjanma? Punarjanma, the cause, what Vedanta, the hypothesis is that karma is the cause for this punarjanma. So if you have to ask, if you say that God has suddenly come and God has created this whole universe, then without any cause, if he has created, there is no question of moksha also. So these two strong reasons we see. But to me, the first reason appears to be stronger, because there may be some people who accept karma, etc. But we have to accept that fact that if you say that God has created at some point of time, the question will come, what was God doing till then? Was he unemployed, underemployed? What was he doing? So that question will be there. So this is an interesting question, interesting shloka. Prakritim purusham chaiva vidhi anadi ubhavapi. So we understood the meaning of anadi. For explaining the meaning of anadi, I took a long, long time. So anadi, that is, there is no origin, there is no beginning for them. Then you see the second line, vikaranscha gunanscheiva vidhi prakriti sambhavan. Then the second line is, it is only a technical terms, vikara. Vikara means from something, from prakriti, there is what is called vikriti. Suppose there is some lump of clay. From that lump of clay, which is prakriti, there are vikara, you have 100 varieties of parts. So 100 varieties of parts, then some plates and what type of, so all types of clay, jars and what not. You make that clay jars in 100 varieties. So all those things are called vikara. Vikara means evolute, if you can use that word evolute. Something that material, the cause is there, from that cause so many effects have come out. They are all called vikara. And vikara of what? Prakriti vikara. Prakriti is that sattva rajasthamo guna. And from that sattva rajasthamo guna, the five bhuta, five elements have come. And from those five elements only, we have got this plant kingdom, animal kingdom, all these things, they are all the vikaras. So vikaranscha, the whole evolutes. And also gunanscheiva. Guna is sattva rajasthamo guna also. Then all these effects, let us say the effects, cause, effect. That lump of clay is the cause. All hundreds of varieties of parts are lump of gold, let us say. Gold is the material. And there are thousands and thousands of shapes. And that gold takes thousands of shapes and forms. Shapes and names, let us say. Names and forms. So they are all vikara. Then the vikaranscha gunanscheiva. And all these effects of these gunas. Vidhi prakriti sambhavan, all these things, vidhi means you know that these are all evolved, they have all evolved from the prakriti only. So the number one, there is what is called kshetram and kshetrajna, what is called this entire universe, and also the knower of the universe. So in the entire universe, we have only seen two categories. The same prakriti is also forming the body-mind complex. And in the same body-mind complex, there is that supreme consciousness which is illumining and making it the enjoyer of the same prakriti. So from the same prakriti, something has come and it is enjoying the same prakriti. And a very crude and harsh example if I have to give, not crude but harsh example, we see dead bodies. Suppose there is a dead body and it is there for a few days, let us say. And what happens to that dead body? So there are what are called maggots. Maggots come out of the dead body. So where have they come from? They have come from the body only. The body, suppose the body is lying there, the body, because of external temperature and all that, if it is a hot place, the body bloats and so much of decomposition takes place, and we call it a decomposition. From our point of view, it is all something which is abhorring, it is something which is not even fit to look at, etc. But for the maggot which is coming from that is the source, that is its birth. That is its birth, and that is something, it is relishing it, it is coming out from that, and then the maggot is actually eating that body. So what we call something which is disgusting, that disgusting thing is the life source for something else. So that is a very, very harsh example if I want to give. Because from the same Prakriti, the body-mind complex is derived. And the same Prakriti you are enjoying. The same, from my eye corresponds to the light, external light. The sense of touch corresponds to the element called air. My sense of smell corresponds to what is called Bhumi or Earth. So the same senses, they are going after the sense objects. This also we will see in the next shloka. So vikaransha gunansheva vidhi prakriti sambhavan, all these vikaras, they are all all these things, they have evolved from the prakriti only. They have not come from anywhere else. Because there is only one prakriti, and for that one prakriti is the source for all the beings. So we will continue tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.